Good morning, church. Let's stand to our feet. Let's raise our voice and sing our praise as loud as we can to the King of Kings. And welcome to Bethel on this Mother's Day. We hope that you are here and you are blessed this morning. We pray that your praises would be glorifying to the Lord. So this morning, whether you came here with a mother or not a mother, we want you to be encouraged. We want you to trust into the Lord and give all of your cares to Him. Father, thank you, Lord, for this morning. For God, your blessings in our lives. We love you and we praise you in your name. Amen. Weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. For the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Oh, there's power in his name. There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. Every war he wages, he will win. I'm not backing down from any giant. I know how this story ends. Yes, I know how this story ends.
I'm gonna see a victory.
victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. Yes, I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. Joshua 1:9 says, "This is my command. Be strong and courageous. Never be afraid or discouraged, because I am your God, the Eternal One, and I will remain with you wherever you go." So this morning we're talking about seeing a victory. Maybe you're walking through something right now and you don't see victory in your future. But you've got the King of Kings, the Eternal One, who says, "Never be discouraged, because I am your God and I remain with you." Cast your cares on him this morning, and you can sing in faith that you're going to see a victory. He works those things together for your good, and there is victory in your future. That bridge is so powerful. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. Sing, you take. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. Come on, claim that this morning. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil. Make it personal. And you turn it for my good. You turn it for my good. Thank you, Jesus, that we find victory in you. You are holy and above all and know all and see all. And we trust you, Jesus, with our victory in your name. Thank you, Jesus.
All the angels are falling on their faces. The foot of the highest of thrones. All of heaven is caught up in the moment. Full of worship, our hearts overflow. Are breaking into pieces. The end.
You speak and waters crash upon the sand. The oceans push and pull at your command. You hold the moon and stars within your hands. And all with just a breath the world began. We sing, God, there's nobody like you, God. There's nobody like you, God. And there will never be.
There'll never be anyone.
sing, your name is greater.
Your name is greater than any name I know. Your throne is higher than any other throne. You are the author, the creator of it all. You stand alone. You stand alone.
Thank you, Lord.
And 'tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Oh Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust.
Sing, I'm so glad.
And I'm so glad I learned to trust him. Precious Jesus, Savior and friend. And I know that he is with me, will be with me to the end. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him. Oh, Jesus, sing, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him o'er and o'er. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust, oh, for grace, and oh, for grace to trust him more.
Thank you. Amen. Amen. Jesus, that's our prayer, that we would have grace to trust you more and more. We love you. Amen. You may be seated.
May every mom joining us here today feel honored, celebrated, and seen. For moms who are expecting and living in the middle of the joys, the fears, and the curiosity, God is faithful. For mothers with little ones who are living between the beauty of being a mom and the feeling of not doing enough, God is faithful. For moms with teenagers who exist in the push and pull of being too near and not being near enough, God is faithful. For moms in the empty nest, who are living in the tension of will they be okay and the honesty of did I do okay? God is faithful. For grandmothers who are living every day with devotion, worry, wisdom, and a lot of praying, God is faithful. So let's make this a day of celebrating mothers and also a day of declaring the faithfulness of God over them. God is faithful to fulfill His promises. He's faithful to make a way where there seems to be no way. He's faithful to be the light when our faith grows dim and to be the song when we're too exhausted to sing. God is faithful to love us, carry us, form us, and restore us. And the very same God who has begun this good work in us will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. All because He is faithful. Happy Mother's Day.
Good morning and happy Mother's Day to all of our lovely mothers out there. Yeah? All right. So we are doing our Mother's Day raffle. So mothers, you have your green ticket. You put the other one in here. So hopefully you didn't put the one that you have away, and we can do this in one take. Okay? So, all right, hold on. All right, I got one. You ready? All right, 551373. All right, come up. Right. And as she's coming up, we're going to have Pastor Vic come up and share with what's going on with the Albany Teen Challenge and what they have going on there. Here you go. Congratulations. You're good. Pastor Vic, here you go.
Thank you, sir. God bless you. Good morning. Happy Mother's Day to all of the mothers. As Pastor Dave shared, I am the director of Albany Adult and Teen Challenge. For those of you who don't know who we are and what we do, God has commissioned us to be a refuge and a place for men and women who find themselves under the sin of the bondage of addiction. And so we share with them the hope of the gospel, so that they can experience the liberty that was won some 2,000 years ago on Calvary's cross. And so thanks, Pastor Steve, for giving us this opportunity. We have a table set up in the foyer. We are celebrating our golf tournament. And so for all of you golfers who are out there, you can stop by the table, get some information. The tournament is Monday, June 26th. Monday, June 26th. And for any of you business owners, this is a way that you can sow into this ministry by sponsoring, becoming a tournament sponsor. So we thank you, and hopefully we will see you in the lobby after service.
Thank you, Pastor Vic. Great work there at Albany Teen Challenge. Before we jump into the message this morning, one more quick reminder. This Tuesday, there are school board elections everywhere, every school district, wherever you live, you have school board elections coming up this week. And, you know, there's a trend that I've kind of been made aware of where if you're a homeschooler, you're not thinking about school board elections. If your kids are at a private school, McKeel, or maybe you send them to Our Saviors or something, you're not thinking about these. And if you're 50 and your kids aren't in school anymore, you're certainly not thinking about these. If you're a grandparent, you're certainly not thinking about these. There's about 18,000 voters in the Mahoneson District. 1,300 showed up last year. So I share this with you because we're asking all hands to be on deck for this, especially those in the Mahoneson School District. The Shalemont School District has two people running for two openings, so it's kind of like meh. There's other races in Gilderlin, in Duanesburg, in Scotia that you can certainly look into. But We know there's some crazy things going on in our school, and we have a couple people locally who are willing to stand up against that. This is not a paid position, the school board. This is not a Republican or Democrat thing. This is just advocating for our children. So I want to encourage you, if you are against filth in the school libraries, if you're against gender-neutral bathrooms for kindergartners, what? Huh? Okay. If you're against basically just the promotion of values that fly in the face of your faith and what you believe, I want to encourage you to get out and vote. We have some good people that you can vote for, so I hope you can go ahead and do that. But that is tomorrow, and that is from 7 a.m. to 9 a.m. at Mahanison. Check your other school districts, and we will go ahead and go from there. Tuesday, thank you. Tuesday. I got in trouble one year on Facebook. I said because of great voter turnout, they're opening voting early for Democrats only, and that they should come. Yeah, and jail. Can't make those jokes. So, all right. Let's move on. It is Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to all the moms out there. Let's give them a round of applause. We are certainly blessed with all of the wonderful mothers here at Bethel. I found a little informal online survey. It was actually one of my friend's churches did this, and it was a list, the top things a mom wants for Mother's Day. The top things a mom wants for Mother's Day. Some serious, some not so much. So here they were. Number one, more time. More time. It goes quick, doesn't it? It goes so quick. We graduated our oldest yesterday from college, and I still see her as like a six-year-old with goggles in the pool. Time flies. More time. Another mom asked for patience. They have too much time, apparently, so they need some patience to navigate the time. A nap. Yeah. Hallelujah. A babysitter. There we go. One lady wrote this. A nap, a compliment, reassurance that I'm doing a good job, a nap, chocolate, coffee, a nap. So, yeah, that seems solid. That seems solid. Peace and quiet. Good luck with that. Encouragement. We can do that. One mom put, children who listen. A mother of teenagers has entered the chat. children who listen. A nap. That's a good one. Bottle of wine. Some Catholics commented, I see. Oh, just kidding. I meant Baptist. I was joking. You're good. Chocolate cake. Solid. A conversation with an adult. Hilarious. And most of all, a nap. So there's your list. And it seems pretty solid. So moms, I hope you get all that you are hoping for this morning. I know we thank God for all the wonderful mothers we have here. So for Mother's Day, we're going to take a break from our Culture War series just for a week. We'll come back to it next week. So everyone who made the jokes about what topic I would address on Mother's Day, we're taking a break for a week, so calm down, all right? But we will be back and hitting it next Sunday. This morning, I want to talk about a Bible story from 1 Samuel chapter 1. I want to talk to you this morning a little bit about Hannah. A little bit about Hannah. We read, she doesn't get a ton of print about her story, but we hear enough about it here in 1 Samuel chapter 1, and it's a message, absolutely, if you're here today, you're a mother, this is going to speak to your heart. But here's the great thing about the Word of God, it's not just for mothers. If you're here today and you're a father, this will also speak to your heart. If you're here today and you're single, this will speak to your heart. If you're here today and you're following Jesus, this will speak to your heart. If you're here today and you're not sure if you want to follow Jesus, this will speak to your heart. Covers all of it. So we're going to talk about Hannah this morning from 1 Samuel chapter 1. The passage is about 20 verses. I'm going to read through the verses and just kind of comment as we go and then share a couple of the key points at the end here. So I'm in 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 1. This is the English Standard Version if you're trying to follow along. Verses will be on the screen. There was a certain man of Ramathaim Zophim in the hill country of Ephraim whose name was Elkanah, the son of Jehoram, son of Elihu, son of Tohu, son of Zoph, and Epaphrite. He had two wives. Great. We'll just start there. He had two wives. The name of one was Hannah. The name of the other, I want to say Panini, but it's Panina. We're going to call her Panini. And Panina had children, and Hannah did not. So let's start with the elephant in the room. The dude had two wives. Not one wife, not one woman that he could make miserable. No, no. Two that his poor husbanding can affect. Multiple wives. And I've had guys tell me before, hey, how come there's polygamy in the Old Testament? Is that how we should do it? And again, you can't even manage one. You are like up to your neck with that. You could not handle two. But that's not it. The reason is because God tells us what marriage is supposed to be. He tells us it's one man, one woman for life. That is the biblical pattern. No matter how many times we've strayed from the biblical pattern, no matter how many times situations in life have caused us to run adjacent to that and mess it up, it's still God's pattern. It's still God's way. It's still the best way. This is absolutely what God desires, and then there are situations in life where it doesn't work out that way. Polygamy. In the Bible, it records things. But if you've ever been in a Bible study here, you've heard me say this before. Just because the Bible records it doesn't mean the Bible approves it. The Bible records polygamy. It doesn't mean the Bible approves it. The Bible records adultery. It certainly doesn't approve it. The Bible records some murders. The stance of the Bible is anti-murder. So just because it's in the Bible, don't assume that's the model. Take, for example, Abraham and Sarah, for those of you who are familiar with the story, when he lied and said, she's really my sister. The Bible recorded it, but the message of Scripture when it comes to lying is don't. Don't do it. So just because the Bible records it doesn't mean the Bible approves it. So yeah, he had two wives, and here comes a shocker. You're never going to see this coming. There were problems with the two of them. Who knew? Who knew? In fact, if you did a little study and you went through, when you look at the different biblical characters with multiple wives, it was never in a favorable light that it's discussed. Strife and conflict always characterized these relationships with multiple wives, concubines, when we see it in the Bible. And we know that there was an intense competitive relationship between Penina and Hannah, the one who could have kids and the one who couldn't. Now, verse 3 says, now this man used to go up year by year from his city to worship and to sacrifice to the Lord of hosts at Shiloh, where the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, were the priests of the Lord. This man would go up according to the law of Moses. He couldn't just worship anytime he wanted to. There were certain times and certain places where you were to go and offer your sacrifices in the Old Testament. Here they were to bring him to the tabernacle, to the priests, and this was located in Shiloh. Verse 4, and on the day when Elkanah sacrificed, he would give portions to Penina, his wife, and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah, he gave a double portion because he loved her, even though the Lord had closed her womb. So there's a ceremonial meal that would take place at the sacrifice. And when he would divide up the meal, he would take care of Penina and her children, but he would give the best, the most, the double portion to Hannah. And it tells us why. Because he loved her more. He loved Hannah. Verse 6 says, and the rival used to provoke her grievously, to irritate her. Provoked, grievous, irritated, because the Lord had closed her womb. So it went on year by year. As often as Hannah went up to the house of the Lord, she would be provoked by Peninnah. Therefore, Hannah wept and would not eat. I think this is interesting here because things weren't going great for Hannah. Yet, time after time, she would show up at the house of the Lord. She still went. She's still faithful. But you probably figure this out. When you walk into this building, your problems didn't stay in the parking lot. Unless your husband's still out there, in which case. When you walked in the building today, your problems came in with you. The things you were worried about this morning are still there. The pain you're experiencing probably didn't magically leave. And we see this all the time, and it's a good example here with Hannah, where the problems at home made her times in the presence of the Lord worse. Because when we come in and we come in with our baggage and we come in heavy and everything else, if we don't do something about it, it affects our time in God's house, in God's presence. Hannah was here at the house of the Lord. She was loved. She was blessed with a double portion. She couldn't even enjoy it because of what was going on in her life and in her heart. Verse 8. And this is the husband just saying the most husband thing ever. He meant well, but he's just such a guy. Elkanah, her husband, said to her, Hannah, why do you weep? Why do you not eat? And why is your heart sad? Am I not more to you than 10 sons? That is such a guy thing, right? He meant well, ladies. And listen, your husband means well too. Sometimes words are hard. That was supposed to encourage her. That was the thought. It wasn't great. It was not his best work. It says in verse 9, after they had eaten and drunk in Shiloh, Hannah rose. Now Eli the priest was sitting on the seat beside the doorpost of the temple of the Lord. And Hannah was deeply distressed, and she began to pray to the Lord. And she wept bitterly. She vowed a vow. She said, O Lord of hosts, if you will indeed look on the affliction of your servants and remember me, not forget your servant, but will give to your servant a son, then I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and no razor shall touch his head. That no razor was a vow that the Jewish people would make. It was called the Nazarite vow, where they were dedicating their kids to the Lord. They wouldn't touch wine or strong drink. They would have their head shaved. Usually that vow was just for a period of time. But Hannah here says, all the days of his life, I'll give him to you. Goes on in verse 12, she continued to pray before the Lord. And Eli, the priest, sitting in the back, observed her mouth. Verse 13 tells us Hannah was speaking in her heart, but only her lips moved, right? It's like one of them silent prayers. Like, I don't want to say it out loud. No words were coming out, but how many of you know God still hears, right? God still hears the prayers of our heart. So she's praying, she's doing her thing. The lips are moving, but there's nothing coming out. She's not feeling great anyway. She's been through a lot. There's some family drama that came into the temple with her this day. She's feeling the weight of her inadequacies, of the problems in her life. So now the man of God is going to step up and encourage her heart. So Hannah was speaking in her heart, only her lips moved and her voice was not heard. Therefore, Eli took her to be drunk. Eli said to her, "How long will you go on being drunk? Put your wine away from you." And that's going to be our text for today. This is what we're going to talk about. Okay, no, not really. In her brokenness, in her pain, she's crying out to the Lord. And the priest, who does not have a read on the situation, he's not really hearing from God in this moment. He's like, hey, you, drinking a little too much? Stop it. Not a word of encouragement, not like, the Lord is with you, my daughter. It was, hey, lay off the bottle, lady. It's insult to injury. Hannah responds, says, "No, my Lord, I'm but a woman troubled in spirit. I have not drunk neither wine nor strong drink, but I've been pouring out my soul before the Lord." Pouring out her soul before the Lord. This is exactly what Hannah needed to be doing. Instead of keeping all the bitterness inside, instead of being anguished in her heart, she pours it out before the Lord. She continues, verse 16, "Do not regard your servant as a worthless woman, for all along I have been speaking out of my great anxiety and vexation." Then Eli answered, hopefully he started with, "Sorry about the drunk thing." Okay, scripture doesn't record that, but maybe his tone implied it. "Then Eli answered, 'Go in peace, and may the God of Israel grant your petition that you have made to him.' She said, 'Let your servant find favor in your eyes.' Then the woman went her way and ate, and her face was no longer sad." Kind of interesting here. God used a priest who totally missed it the first time to speak words of blessing that were spot on the second time. It's almost like you can be in ministry and not always be perfect. It's crazy. So you get it wrong sometimes. Who knew? Bizarre. Glad that doesn't happen here. Verse 19 says, "They rose early in the morning and worshiped before the Lord. And they went back to their house at Ramah. And Elkanah knew Hannah, his wife, and the Lord remembered her. And in due time, Hannah conceived and bore a son, and she called his name Samuel, for she said, 'I have asked for him from the Lord.'" Story ends where God answers her prayer. The words of the priest come to fruition. A year later, Hannah shows up at the temple, baby in hand. God answered the prayer. As we look through this story, I want to break it down and learn some lessons from Hannah, and lessons that will absolutely, positively apply to us as well, whether you're a mother or not, whether you're male or female, young or old. Just some general lessons from the text that talk about who we are before God, difficult circumstances that will arise in our life, and the faithfulness of our God through the entire journey. So it's the story of Hannah, but it's really for each and every one of us. As this story begins, we're told that she was the most loved. She was the most loved. And at the beginning of the story here, it's a reminder of God's incredible love for you and I. This is worth noting. This is worth noting if you've ever felt unloved. This is worth noting if ever in your life you felt rejected or betrayed or abandoned. This is important if any time in your life you just felt like you weren't loved enough. We're reminded at the beginning of this story how her husband loved her, but it's a symbol and it's a reminder for us about how much our Heavenly Father loves us. The love of God for you and for me. Despite her problems, despite what she's going through, despite how she feels about everything, she was loved. And the same thing is true for every person listening this morning. It's even true for the people who aren't listening. God loves us. He loves all of us. The Bible says when you were a sinner, Jesus died for you. The Bible says for all of us have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. When we were his enemies, Jesus loved us and he died for us. The Son of God, the creator of the universe, feels that way about you. That's pretty good. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter what your past is. It doesn't matter what hoops you've had to jump through. It doesn't matter who's hurt you. Know at this very moment, no matter who you are today, this is how God feels about you. He is madly, over the moon, wondrously in love with you. That means he cares about you. He sees you when you're hurting. He knows your needs. God loves us. This is a real important reminder. And God loves us even when we're a mess. This is big. This is big because we practice an imperfect love. When people do the things we want them to do, we love them. There's almost a performance return kind of exchange when we love people. But God teaches us another kind of love. God loves us not because of us, but because of who he is. He loves us perfectly. So when you are a terrible human being, you know who you are. God's love for you doesn't diminish. Wow, what? That's crazy. You could be sitting here today, angry with God. No faith in your life or your past. And he loves you today as much as he loves the person next to you, the person talking to you. The love of God, even though we're imperfect, even though we're a mess sometimes. That's important to remember. And you know what? There's some times in life and there's some people we struggle with trying to look perfect. We struggle with, you know, oh, it's Mother's Day. Let's get the Instagram photo in front of the flowers out there. Perfect family, perfect husband. You want to murder two of the three of the people in your family. But we don't talk about that because it's Mother's Day and we want to look good. And I get it. And people, you know, hey, how are you doing? Oh, great. Everything's great. Blessed by the best and highly favored. I think, is that Dave Ramsey or something? I don't know. Better than I deserve. That was the Dave Ramsey one. We have all the little cliches and everything. Oh, we're great. We're good. Everything's wonderful. Sometimes we strive for some perfectionism on the outside, but we know on the inside, I need you, Jesus. And that's it. And listen, if that perfectionism becomes a wall, you can't do what Hannah does at the end here, right? At the end, Hannah doesn't care who's looking or if they think she's drunk or crazy. She's at the altar pouring her heart out to God, right? And God meets her there. God's not looking for perfect people, but he will gladly take some people who will fall on their face before him and cry out and say, God, I need you. God, I need you. And this is Hannah. This is where she's at. She's most loved, loved by God, blessed by God, at the end, remembered by God. But despite all of this, she had some problems. Hannah had no children. She was barren. despite being loved, there were some things lacking. Despite being loved, everything wasn't perfect. There were problems. And you know, for some people, this becomes a real hiccup in their faith. Because we need to remember, the presence of adversity does not equate to the absence of God. The presence of problems or trials or struggles, that doesn't mean that God's not there. Many times in our life, God uses hardships and trials, struggles. God's going to use this in Hannah's life. Maybe you're going through something this morning. And you're thinking to yourself, well, God can't love me. Well, we already covered that. And now you're thinking, well, if God did love me, I wouldn't be going through all these problems. Well, now we're covering that too. Just because there's problems doesn't mean God's not there. God works through our adversity. God is close to us in times of adversity. God was with Hannah even in her heartache, even in all of her imperfections, even when nothing was going the way she wanted it to go, God was still close to her. You know, there's these seasons in life when we feel like we can't catch a break, like nothing's going well. We pray and we feel like the prayers are just bouncing off the ceiling. I want you to know God is with you. God is right next to you. Even if your prayers bounce off the ceiling, he's not that far away. He's right here. He's right with you. He hears you when you cry. He knows your heart. He knows what you're going through. Just because you're in a difficult season, don't throw in the towel on your faith. Do what Hannah did. Run to God. Cry out to God. That seems to be the answer. That seems to be the solution. And let me tell you this about the problems. Let me tell you this about the struggles and everything else. You know who she has that in common with? Every single person in Scripture. And every single person in this room today. Everyone. Every mother in Scripture. That I could preach any one of them. Every single one of them went through hardship and had to trust God. Every guy in Scripture. Same thing. Hardship, have to trust God. Every person in this room this morning, hardship. We like to think when there's a problem, when there's a hardship, when there's pain, that we are the only ones in the world who are suffering, and no one knows how bad I have it and what's going on with me, and I know there's some terrible things that happen in life. But please understand this, God is near. He is with you. He hasn't left you. He hasn't traded you in. He's not like, well, I tried to help you. I'm on to the next guy now. You're out. That's not God. He's with us. Be encouraged this morning, Mom. God is with you, and he sees every single tear. He knows. Be encouraged today. Dads, God knows what's going on the inside, not the front that we put on. God knows what we're thinking and feeling and where we're struggling. No matter who you are, no matter what your age is, God is with you. He's near. The presence of adversity does not equate to the absence of God. On top of this, we also see that she was provoked. She was having a hard enough time on her own. She didn't need help. She was just struggling with what she was dealing with. Now she's got an enemy. There's someone in her life to just be like, does this hurt here? Push a little extra, a little salt for the wound. We're not supposed to have enemies. We're Christians. We're supposed to love everybody. Love the sinner. Hate the sin, right? Jesus says, love your enemies. But she had one. As much as it depended on her, she wouldn't want one, but she had one. Someone to push her buttons, someone to mess with her. When you're feeling bad, to offer a word to make you feel just a little bit worse. And that's what Peninnah was for her. Opposition. Sometimes it's people. Sometimes it's situations. Sometimes it's philosophies, ideologies. In all of this, we're reminded You're still loved. She was still loved by her husband. And you're still loved by your heavenly Father. But at some point, it kind of starts to feel like that snowball is rolling downhill and starting to get bigger. Like it started with, oh, I had some, you know, some personal things in the family. They weren't going great. And the snowball starts going, oh, and I found out I can't have kids. And oh, the snowball's going bigger. And, oh, my husband took another wife and she's giving me grief constantly. And the snowball's getting bigger. So finally, she goes to church and the priest is like, hey, you drinking? And the snowball gets bigger and you feel like you're ready to just be crushed under it. But in all of this, she still loved. Things weren't perfect. She was provoked. Now she comes to the temple of God where she's misunderstood by the priest, by the spiritual leader, by the one guy who should have known better. He should have called out Peninnah and been like, hey, stop acting like that. Be better. Have some compassion. Nope. Instead, he says, you drink it? As her heart is breaking before the Lord. Boy, you ever feel misunderstood? People are quick to pass judgment, too quick to pass judgment. You ever just feel like no one gets it? Like, even those who are trying to listen a little bit, they don't understand you. You know what really fries me? This is way up high on the list. When people question, not my actions, like if I do something stupid, it is what it is, okay? Not even my words. I said it. I got to stand by it or apologize for it. That's okay. When people question my motives or my intentions, right? You ever go through a hard time and you're doing your best to navigate the problem and then someone comes up and they're like, well, you're just doing this because you're a, and I'm like, nah, no, but now I have to deal with another issue. You. Here she is. Hannah is broken. She's weeping before the Lord. She's trying to do the right thing. She's trying to handle her situation in a godly way. And someone who should have known better, someone who should have had some insight from God or at least some common sense, the priest comes to her and says, you can't be drinking this early, Hannah. You need to stop hitting the bottle. He didn't just ask her if she was drinking. He told her. You can't be drunk. Put away your wine. Totally misunderstood. Her motivations completely questioned and challenged. So what does she do? As a snowball just becomes too great. We read this. She prayed. In her distress, she turned to God. She didn't turn to social media. She turned to God. She didn't turn to the wine. She turned to God. Didn't turn to her girlfriends. Didn't go into a depression. Didn't turn to immorality. In all of this, she didn't seek to escape. She turned to God for strength, for God to answer. All those other things just worsen the situation, but Hannah gives her situation to the Lord. And God does something wonderful. God answers. God answers. Let me tell you something about these stories in the Bible. There's a lot of them, and there's a lot of characters. There's a lot of amazing things that happen. But only one is the hero in every single story. And his name is Jesus. In every story, in every account, in Hannah's situation, God is the hero of this story. And in the story, we learn more about God and who he is. God answers Hannah And we learn a couple things about God. First, we learn that he's watchful. We learn that God is always watching and he knows our needs. Scripture tells us that the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous and his ears are open to your prayers. If you are here this morning and you've accepted Jesus as the Savior of your life, know those two things. His eyes are watching over you and his ears are listening. God's watching. Not watching like a referee looking to put you in the penalty box, but like a loving father to be there for their son, to protect, to love, to guide, to instruct. Not there ready to hit the smite button, bring down judgment from heaven as soon as you're out of line. It's not what God does. He's watching over you. Why? Because he cares about us. We learn in this story that God is watchful. We also learn here that God is merciful. He's merciful. God sympathizes with us, with pain, with loss, with weakness. Hebrews 4, 15 and 16 says, "For we do not have a high priest, Jesus, who's unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who in every respect has been tempted like we are, yet without sin." Jesus knows what you're going through because he left heaven and he came to earth and he lived for 33 years. Jesus saw loved ones die. Jesus saw friends go through difficulties. Jesus saw the effects of sickness, sin, and disease in a world all around him. Jesus ultimately knew what it meant to suffer. He himself betrayed, nailed to a cross. Hebrews says, this great high priest can sympathize with you, can sympathize with us, can be merciful towards us because he went through it, because he lived it. And because of that, verse 16, then let us go with confidence. Let us go boldly, the King James tells us, to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace in time of need. This is such a wonderful lesson to learn, such an important attribute of God. Maybe you had a father who was a disciplinarian. Maybe you had a father who wasn't in the picture. Maybe your father didn't handle things and he was real easy on things. I want you to know your heavenly father is merciful. He's merciful. He's there. He loves you. He would rather go through it on earth for you than spend eternity without you. And this is what Jesus did for us, a merciful Father. And because he's merciful, his children should be quick to go to him in prayer. He's watching. He knows what you're going through. He knows what you've said and what you feel and what you think. He truly knows the motivations of your heart. And because he's merciful, he invites us to come anyway. Come and cry out to me. Come and make your prayers known. God is listening. God is open. We know he's watchful. We know he's merciful. And I'll ask the worship team to join us as we close. Lastly, and certainly as important as any of them, he's powerful. Our God is powerful. God moves. He moves even in impossible situations. There's nothing that our God cannot do. There is no sickness too great for our God. There is no hardship too great. There is no relationship so broken. There is nothing that our God cannot do. And the greatest miracle of all is testified by so many sitting here this morning. God saved your soul. Amen. And you were lost. And you were a mess. And outside of God, there was no hope. people probably said that about, oh, that guy doesn't have a chance. Oh, she's so far gone. You want to talk about a miracle? The God of the universe reached you. He came to you. He got your attention. This church is filled with miracles this morning. Hopelessly lost and then found by the grace of God. Our God's watchful and he's merciful, but he's also powerful. There's no chain he can't break. Amen? There's no problem too big. There's no diagnosis too grim. There's no principality or power or spiritual wickedness in this world that our God cannot overcome. We need to remember not only that we're loved, not only that he cares and he's watching, but in the middle of all of our problems, we serve a God who's greater than all of them. He's greater than all of them. Our God is powerful. Maybe you're here today, you need a miracle. Maybe you need God to move in an impossible situation. Maybe you're here today and you're praying for a miracle of salvation, for a friend, a family member, a loved one. God can answer all those prayers. There's another miracle that God does for us. And I kind of feel like when we're going through it, we don't appreciate this miracle so much. It's the miracle of strength. It's the miracle of endurance. That we could be going through a really hard time. And I know how I pray in hard times. Like, God, deliver us. Deliver us from evil. Lord, remove this hardship. Calm the storm. Remove this person. Whatever the prayer is. God, fix it. Make it better. And sometimes God works another way. He gives you the strength to go through something. The Bible tells us that those who wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. They'll rise up with wings like eagles. They'll walk and not be weary, not faint. Some of you are here today, not because God answered your prayer for healing or your prayer for deliverance, but instead in his wisdom and his sovereignty, he gave you strength to get through where you were. And at the time, it's not really what you were praying for, but in hindsight, you can look back at seasons in your life and you think of that old Footprints poem painting where when there was just the one set of footprints, God was carrying us. He gave us strength as long as we went to him. Church, we're going to continue to pray for miracles. We're going to continue to pray for God's provision, for God's deliverance, for chains broken, for families restored. We're going to continue to pray for all of that. But you know, along with that, what God does? He gives us his strength. And if you feel like you're at the end of your rope, God gives you strength. When you feel like you can't keep going the way things are, God gives you strength. Don't overlook. When we're talking about the power of God, don't overlook the miracle of the strength that he gives you and what you've already overcome through his strength and how far you've come because of his strength. Easy to forget. Easy to forget where we are, where we were. But he's still providing those miracles. He's still providing those miracles. As we close today, I'm going to have the altar team come and join me up front here. I got a couple things I want you to think about before we go ahead and the team plays this final song. And if you're here today and you need to have a relationship with Jesus, maybe you're here, I'm not asking if you go to church or if you come to this church, how is your relationship with Jesus? Because the sad truth is, you can sit in church for years, you can sit in this church week after week and not have a relationship with Jesus. So my question for you this morning is, how is your relationship with Jesus? And if you need to begin that relationship, there's men and women here who would love to pray with you. If you need to work on that relationship, there's people who would love to pray with you as well. Maybe you're here today and you need to repent. Now, we've been defining repentance. It's changing our mind. Changing my mind about how I think about God, how I think about sin, how I think about my need for Jesus. If God is changing your mind this morning, I want to encourage you to come. And if you're a mom and you just need some of that strength we've been talking about, you're praying for God to do something powerful in your life, I'd invite you to come. And this one last thing, for each and every one of us, we heard the word this morning for 30, 40 minutes. God spoke to your hearts. Ask yourself this question: God, what are you saying to me, and what do you want me to do with this? Don't let this just be Sunday. Just, oh yeah, we went to church, worship was good, preaching was good, there were flowers, it was good. Let's be more than that today. And ask the Holy Spirit to answer that question. God, what are you speaking to me? What do you want me to do with what I've heard today? How do you want me to respond to what I've heard today? Would you pray that with me? And as we close the service, respond as God is telling you to respond. Let's stand together as we close. I want to pray over you right now. Thank you, Jesus. If you're here this morning and you have a need, I encourage you just right where you are, put your hands up, put them in a receiving position. God wants to give you strength and power. God wants to heal and touch and set you free. Lord, we're needy. God, we have problems. Lord, we have enemies. Father, we're misunderstood so many times, but above it all, we're loved by the King. God, you love us. You demonstrate your love for us as your Son gave his life on the cross. And Father, you see every tear. You hear every prayer. Lord, you're mighty. You care about us. You're powerful. Nothing we're facing that you can't need. So Lord, we pray this morning, heal, deliver, provide. Lord, give direction, break chains. God, restore, make whole again. Do what only you can do. And Lord, give us strength to walk with you, to stay in the fight, to not lose focus. Lord, I thank you that you love us and that you care about us. Not because of what we've done, because of who you are. Thank you for that amazing love. God, I pray this morning, meet us here. Meet us here. Touch some hearts today. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. If you need prayer this morning, I want to encourage you. Find a spot up here at this altar. Come on down. Let's close this service and be praying. Be asking that question. God, what do you want from me? What are you speaking to me? God has a plan for you. Thank you.
Holy, holy, we'll never stop singing to you. Holy, 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 Jesus, it's only for you. Holy, holy, holy. Stop singing to you, holy.
of the highest of thrones, all of heaven is caught up in the moment, full of worship, our hearts overflow. Father, thank you that you are always here beside us. You see us, you hear us, and you sympathize with our struggle. We love you, Lord. Help us as we go out this week and we practice casting our cares on you. Be glorified in us in your name. Amen.
I'm confident.
Of what?
I'll see it again and again. You love and I've witnessed it.
How you love us.
You heal and I've witnessed it. You save and I've witnessed it. And I'm confident. I'll see it again and again. You're good.